Adequate notice of this January 22nd, 2024 regular monthly meeting of the Cranford Board of Education was provided on December 14th, 2023 by a meeting notice posted in the boardroom, Lincoln School, and communicated to the Star Ledger, the Westfield Leader, the Office of the Township Clerk, and all board members. Please rise for the flag salute.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mrs. Cohen. Mr. Darling.
Here.
I'm sorry.
You didn't let her say yes yet, huh?
Mr. Darling.
Here.
I'm looking for you over here. See, it's going to be a long day. Okay, I'm just going to say that. Mr. Dreyer.
Here.
Mr. Hulse.
Here.
Mr. Colubus.
Here.
Mr. Lynch.
Here.
Mrs. Shaw.
Here.
Mrs. Soltis.
Here.
Mr. Petchow.
Here.
We have quorum.
Thank you.
Doctor?
Dr. Rubin, I'm going to throw it right to you.
Great. Thank you very much, Mr. Petchow. Good evening, everyone. Wonderful to see you. We'll start off with one of our highlights of our board meeting, and that is hearing from our student liaison. So we're going to start off over at Hillside Avenue School. I believe we've got Bella Stolpin and Aiden Chang, and their advisor, Mr. Bergardner, is here. So I'll toss it over to you.
Good evening. I hope you all have a nice break and are recharged for the start of the new year. The Rise Against Hunger Fundraising Pajama Day. Middle school students all wore their pajamas on December 20th to participate. We were able to raise money to help for Rise Against Hunger and the meal peak for later in the year. The Season of Giving Food Drive has an update. The second grade collected 720 pounds of food. This was enough to provide 600 meals at the Community Food Bank of New Jersey for families in need this holiday season. Assembly. 7th and 8th grade each had separate assemblies on the topics of name-calling and bullying. It was a good reminder to be nice to your classmates, and it also helped build a better school community. Music Holiday Caroling. The middle school band, chorus, and strings all put together a great performance on Friday the 22nd. They performed for all of HAS. They really put us in the holiday spirit.
The HAS Esports Club also participated in midnight gaming at the high school. The students participated in various tournaments to show off their gaming skills, and everyone had a great time there, and hopefully they have another tournament. The Hillside Prophet, the first issue of the school newspaper, was also released today, and we had 10 students contribute to the paper, and we discussed a wide variety of topics, and it was so great to see the students reading the paper and talking about the hard work the writers and photographers did. That's all. Thank you, and have a great day.
Fabulous. Great job. Thank you so much. Very exciting stuff going on over at Hillside. Let's head over to Orange, and we've got Thomas Villarreal and Haley Concannon.
Good evening, Board of Ed members. I hope you all had a wonderful break, but now it's time to get back into the swing of things with some news from OAS.
The week before winter break, Student Council hosted a competition to guess the amount of erasers in a jar for a $20 gift card downtown. There were 1,176 erasers in the jar, and we raised a total of $70. On December 5th, the Student Council wrote holiday cards for Cranford senior citizens, as well as cards to U.S. veterans. We received a well-appreciated thank you from the state of New Jersey. The boys' basketball team has had a very good start to their season with a 5-1 win-loss record. We hope they keep up the good work. The girls' basketball team is also doing very well, with a record of 3 wins and 3 losses. Trifle Tuesday, a time where middle schoolers can peacefully eat lunch in the library, has resumed. Many people are grateful for this time as they can leave the noise of the lunchroom and enjoy 25 minutes of relaxation. The Orange Avenue Newspaper Club, the Orange Juice, will publish their new article on the 25th. These articles contain interesting information on events in the school as well as opinion pieces on various topics.
The 8th graders of Orange Avenue have recently spoken to the CHS counselors about the electives they can take their freshman year. Soon, each student will meet individually with their counselor and guardian to discuss their schedules in more detail. This year's spring musical will be Willy Wonka. Good luck to all people auditioning. The Student Council applied for the NJ Association of Student Councils Top 10 Projects Award and won. We were awarded Perk a Teacher. Place in November. Council described how it benefited the community and got the community involved. It is safe to say we crushed it. Our beloved Vice Principal, Mr. Van Dam, is retiring this year and will be greatly missed by our students and staff. We are wishing him luck in the next chapter of his life.
Well, that is all from OAS. We look forward to seeing you next month.
Another great job. Thank you, Ms. Rivera. Incredible reports. And last but certainly not least, we'll head over to the high school. Rachel, what's happening over there?
Okay, so to start with performing arts, rehearsals have been ongoing for the spring musical Urinetown to be performed on March 1st, 2nd, and 3rd. And also the Cranford High School hosted its first film festival last Wednesday, which was a big hit. We have a lot of people interested in film at the school, and that program's really grown, which is really great. And our annual open mic night was rescheduled for February 2nd. It's a Friday, originally supposed to be last Friday, but the snow, it moved. So be sure to check that out. The acting crew's been doing that for a while, and it's always great. Additionally, the seniors have started preparing for the senior fashion show, preceding the lock in March. So rehearsals for that are starting after midterms. And also, these performing arts programs welcomed interested eighth graders a few weeks ago on January 4th, where they had the opportunity to sit in on classes and really learn about what those programs were like at the high school to see if they would be interested in participating at them. And additionally, the eighth graders at HAS were introduced to the computer science programs offered by CHS last Thursday through a field trip of those involved in the high school program, just introducing them to those new programs, especially as scheduling starts soon. Also, eighth graders will have their high school orientation, I believe, this coming Wednesday, January 24th at 7, really just welcoming them to the school, getting ready for next year. Going back to the CHS computer science programs, the Girls Who Code Club is continuing their partnership with Girl Scouts to inspire young girls in chem and STEM. And also, midterm exams begin this Thursday, January 25th, and the school is offering a lot of different opportunities to help students feel prepared. Last Thursday, CHS, I know, hosted a wellness fair for families, educating how to cope with different anxieties. And additionally, student volunteers shared their own experiences with midterms in an assembly given to freshmen. And other student mentorship opportunities have been available for freshmen entering their first round of exams, including peer tutoring in the past few weeks. And just to wrap up, I know we have a lot of winter sports senior nights this week if you want to check it out. I know the only date I'm 100% sure on is I know swim senior night is this Wednesday, the 24th, at 4 p.m. right after school if you want to go see that. And I'm pretty sure basketball and wrestling or hockey are this week. I'm not 100% sure on those. But a lot going on with the sports if you want to check that out as well.
Great job, Rachel. Great job to all of you for keeping us posted on all the exciting stuff that's going on in each of the schools. It's really fabulous to hear about all those things going on. You actually brought up the wellness fair, and speaking of our wellness fair, one of the architects of that wellness fair is here with us tonight. That's our director of school counseling and also our anti-bullying coordinator, Lisa Burfine. I know, along with Alyssa Wilner and Tony Anthony, created that, and it was absolutely fabulous last week. And Lisa, I'm also going to ask you to come up and fulfill our biannual reporting on HIB, on harassment, intimidation, and bullying.
Get you to test the microphone really quick right there.
Testing.
All right, that works. You're gonna have to like speak directly into it though, unfortunately.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay,
So as Dr. Rubin said, this is the biannual report for the school safety that we give in Cranford every twice a year. It incorporates the activities, the programs, and the trainings that go on between September 1st and December 31st of 2023. Okay, so these are the things I'm going to go over tonight. You have the presentation in front of you. So the first I'm going to start off with is the HIB definition, just so we all understand what we're talking about when we say harassment, intimidation, and bullying. There are three prongs that must be met in order for something to qualify as harassment, intimidation, and bullying. The first prong one is that whatever the comment or the action or the gesture is must be perceived as being motivated by a particular characteristic, and that characteristic can be anything from height to social status to ethnicity to race. It can really be any particular characteristic of a person or a group of people. The second prong is that the act or the gesture or the comment must cause a substantial disruption for that student, meaning it keeps them from coming to school, they're not able to attend class, they must have an effect on their grades, they need to see a school counselor repetitively, something to that effect that causes a substantial disruption to their education. And then the third prong has actually three parts to it. And the first part is that whatever the act, the comment, or the gesture is, a reasonable person would find that offensive or harmful emotionally or physically. The second part of that prong is that the person, the alleged victim, actually is affected by that, emotionally or physically harmed by that comment, act, or gesture. And lastly, that it also causes a hostile educational environment, which usually is connected to prong two. If there's a substantial disruption, then typically it would also be causing a hostile educational environment for the student or group of students. Thanks, Meg. Sorry. Okay. Each of our schools does have an anti-bullying specialist to be aware of the trends and things that are going on at each of the schools. You can see those names in front of you. Lauren Biggiani is at Brookside in Bloomingdale. She's the counselor there. Tony Anthony is the student assistance counselor at Cranford High School. Stella Siciliano is a social worker at Hillside. Livingston and Walnut is Grace Rivetti, who is currently on maternity leave, but she is the anti-bullying specialist there. And then Joelle Pillick is a member of the child study team at Orange Avenue School. Fortunately for us, as you know, a number of years ago now, we hired a district coordinator of culture and climate, who is also an anti-bullying specialist, and so that all of these lovely people, the counselors and the social workers, can do their jobs and wear the hat of being a counselor or a social worker. Alyssa Wilner is our district coordinator of culture and climate, and she does all the investigations at all of the schools, and obviously has the support of the other anti-bullying specialists to assist in the investigation, but not actually do the investigation itself. It's very helpful when Alyssa is questioning students, that she often has one of these people in the room just to make it a more comfortable environment for either the alleged victim, the alleged offender, or any of the witnesses. Oh, yeah, thank you. Okay, in addition, in our school system, what was passed down a number of years ago is that instead of diving right into an investigation, we do have the opportunity, lawyer approved by our board, to do a pre-screening. And in effect, what that is we talk, if there is an accusation potentially of harassment, intimidation, and bullying, we have an opportunity to talk with the student, to talk with the family, to see on face value if the accusation or the allegation does meet any of the three prongs. So it's the same three prongs that I discussed a couple slides ago, but in essence, we talk with the family, you know, on face value, do you feel this act, this comment, this gesture is perceived to be motivated by a certain characteristic? We then ask about prong two, if there was a substantial disruption, and then prong three. It's not an actual investigation, but it is, like I said, on face value, we ask those questions. And sometimes that does help the family understand what actually HIB is. A lot of times what it turns out to be is a code of conduct issue. So if prongs one, two, and three are not met on face value, we complete a pre-screening. And to date, between the months of September and December 31st, we've had 14 pre-screenings. So again, it's an opportunity to educate families and educate the kids as to what HIV actually is. We still address everything that happened. Like I said, oftentimes it's a code of conduct issue, and all of those things are still addressed and the actions are still the same, but we don't do a full-blown investigation. Oh, it worked this time. Okay. What you have in front of you are the actual investigations that we did do. In addition, as part of this report, we also need to report any incidents of violence or vandalism, substance abuse, or substance use or abuse, and then if there were any weapons brought to school. So you can see by the numbers, obviously, they're very low. We did have some acts of violence at both Cranford and Hillside and Orange, nothing at the K to 5 schools. And then, as you can see, we did have four cases of allegations of HIV. Those were all investigated, but none of them were confirmed. So that is actually a very low number for us. You can all knock on the wood tables that are in front of you. We are starting out the year very slow, which I appreciate. I'm sure as board members you've seen, there have been a number of other cases that you have been put before you as first reads. Those are not reported until they are confirmed in the second read and approved. So those will be in the second report period from January to June, but fingers crossed, it will continue to be a quiet year. I do feel as though, and I'm going to talk about the programs and trainings in a minute, that the things that we've been doing in this district have definitely had finally, you know, after now post-COVID, we can see the effects of all of that in real time. In addition, with all of the four cases that were put before you as part of this report, we do keep track if there were any protected categories that did show that they met prong one, and I'm happy to say that none of the cases that were alleged met prong one, which was a perceived characteristic. These numbers don't really correlate to the actual number of cases or even if a case is, for the actual number of cases that I reported, because again, sometimes they're alleged and they're not confirmed, but like I said, to date, we haven't had any that have met prong one, so there's nothing in any of those categories for now. Okay. The trainings and programs you can see are plentiful in this district. We categorize them district-wide, trainings and programs, and then we also break it down what the individual schools did. There are, like I said, a number at each of the schools and K to 5, 6 to 8, and 9 through 12. And if you look at the next slide, or not, I accidentally turned that off. We'll start with the programs. So these are just a couple of examples of programs that we do either in individual schools or district-wide. No Place for Hate is a district-wide initiative. We collaborate with the Anti-Defamation League, which guides us in designating three activities throughout the year. What we like about the Anti-Defamation League is that they don't just, not that it's not an important message to be kind, they go beyond that. They want to see activities where we're being tolerant of each other, we're being understanding of each other. It's not just random acts of kindness. There's also a pledge that we ask the kids to take to be an upstander, you know, in the face of hate or hate crimes. In addition, our counselors and our social workers deliver SEL lessons every year. They meet the New Jersey Learning Standards. They really focus in on CASEL, which is the five core competencies: self-awareness, social awareness, responsible decision-making, self-regulation. Those are delivered throughout the year, and I will add just a little plug. We very nicely added a full-time sixth grade counselor at one of the middle schools this year. So instead of sharing one sixth grade counselor between the two schools, we now have a full sixth grade counselor at each school, which further is and allows us to deliver these SEL lessons, hopefully to give all the students the tools that they need. So as they grow up, they have that toolbox of coping skills, you know, throughout high school and beyond. Livingston Avenue School is very famous for their full value families. They make individual families that go cross grade, third, fourth, and fifth grade. So it doesn't just focus on third graders with third graders. It really helps the kids make those connections in the entire school. They have meetings once a month where they practice the full value principles. Tranquil lunch, it just sounds wonderful. It gives kids an opportunity to have lunch, maybe not in that crazy environment of the lunchroom. The Lead You Assembly was brought to some of the elementary schools. I don't know if you've ever had an opportunity to participate in a Lead You Assembly. They are a group of high energy individuals that work with kids from kindergarten through adulthood. I was fortunate to attend one at the National Suicide Prevention annual workshop, and they get people up, they get people talking, again, focusing on teaching you skills so that you can be a leader, you know, in your community. Inclusive Schools Week is something that we do in December. Again, it's done district-wide, but there's different activities that are done at each of the schools. It's really to include and to recognize everyone who has differences, which is everyone, every walk of life. So it's a wonderful week that we celebrate here in Cranford. In addition to that, we have some standard trainings that go on every year. There is an HIB presentation, which I've given you a link to, that's at the end of this presentation for grades 4 through 12, that talk about the three prongs that I just talked about with all of you, teaches them what they are. It's a narrated video. We have an anonymous reporting program called Stop It. It teaches the kids how to sign on and report things if they need to. Every school has at least two school and safety meetings every year where they address trends that they see in their school and plan activities to address those trends. Every grade level, K through 12, takes a New Jersey school climate survey every year. It's called New Jersey Sky. That's the new name of it now. But it gives us information, gives us data on what the parents and guardians feel are important or what they feel is missing in the schools. We ask the kids the same questions and we ask the faculty the same questions. So based on that data, the school safety teams set goals and they set activities to address anything that they think needs extra work in their schools. As you know from Cranford, we're great, I'm sorry, as it is, but obviously we're always looking for improvement. So that's the survey that we give out every year. Since the beginning of time, I run a training for, we call it trauma event planning. I used to call it crisis, but then somebody else took that name, so now we call it trauma event planning. It's God forbid, you know, there is a tragic car accident, there is a suicide, there is a death maybe that sweeps the, you know, through the school, there is a fire in someone's house. It's better to overplan. So we have a guide so that we have a template in front of us when something happens so we know who's responsible for what, who's talking to the media, who gets the water, who gets the tissues, who contacts the family, who puts a message out to the faculty. So we have this template that we go through every year. I think the more you plan, the less you need to use it. So that's our motto with that. The district coordinator for culture and climate and I are actually giving a presentation next month. No, I think it's in April. For conflict versus bullying, again, just a further explanation. It's through the Cranford Family Academy. A further explanation so that parents understand and guardians understand and kids understand what the difference is between conflict and bullying. And finally, I feel like the state has caught up with us in doing a training every year. They call it the School Behavioral and Threat Assessment. It's very similar to trauma event management as far as how to respond when there's a crisis, but it also incorporates, God forbid, there is a bomb scare or bomb threat or, you know, something like that. So it incorporates a whole lot more than just the trauma event planning. And we're right on board with that. Mark Canigallo is the head of that committee and has done the training, and there's a number of people in district that have received that training. That concludes my presentation. I did include a number of links here. This will be posted on the website. It's the HIV policy. It's the 338 form, which you can fill out if you want to report HIV. It's the video for conflict versus bullying, so you can watch that in your leisure whenever you want to. I'm sure it's up for an Academy Award or something at some point. Our district website, the Cranford School Counseling Corner, which is just a wealth of resources for really anything under the sun that you may or not even know that you need. So I encourage you to click on it. It's updated frequently, so please go to it when you have time. And other than that, I just will take any questions.
Does any board member have any questions? Please. Thank you.
So just wanted to thank you for your leadership and your passion around this. I mean, I've had the privilege of, you know, listening and seeing you present for a while now, and I can sense that. So thank you. And then also, you know, I don't know how to express this, but I'm pleased to see that decisions the board has made in the past to support the social emotional well-being of our children has come to fruition, and it's helping. Counselors, district coordinator, et cetera. You referenced a few of those things, which jogged my memory on that. So I'm glad that's helping as well. So thank you.
Thank you.
Anyways, please, sir.
I've had the opportunity to work with you over the years, and I say, how much time and effort you put into making certain that our families and our students are taken care of. I really appreciate the template and you saying that you're looking to make certain that we're prepared, if not to send out into the universe that it doesn't happen, but knowing that you're keeping an eye on what could happen to our children is amazing. And I also really appreciate the conflict versus bullying, because I do think that this is something that our community needs to understand the difference when it comes to when something happens with their child. So I think that it's nice that you're doing that with the parent academies. And they're always such good topics, so I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for this tonight. It's always well presented and the information is very informative. One of the feelings that I get listening to this tonight, and you touched on it a little bit, is sort of the seeds that are sown early, you see later. And in some of the statistics, I think maybe we're seeing that tonight. So, you know, just kudos for that, because a lot of the stuff that's done in elementary school, it takes a while, but it's getting there now.
We're getting there.
And it definitely shows. So congratulations on all the good stuff.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay. So I will just wrap up. I always kind of do this when you come and present, and I always put you on the spot and say, you know, what things are you excited about, you know, moving forward and all that. But I'm not going to do that this time because I think you presented it very well. Last board meeting, we had the Cranford JCs had given us had funded Bullies to Buddies. I was just wondering if tonight you could kind of go over what that is and kind of bring that to light to explain to us what you do with that.
Sure. Only if you promise not to roll your eyes when I present that in the next quarter.
Because
we have someone coming to do that presentation in the next month. So the Bullies to Buddies program is something that was brought to us by Connie Palmer, who we initially met through Imagine, which is a grief support service that's located in Mountainside. She's an amazing social worker. She trained us on to be a grief-informed school district, and we continue to, once she trained us, now we deliver those lessons to our sixth graders and also run parent nights to understand that loss is a part of life and how to cope with that. But then she brought this other program to us called Bullies to Buddies, which is in essence a different approach. Obviously, we do, I'm sure, you know, if you're a parent here or you've babysat or whatever it is, you tell the kids, if someone says something mean to you or someone does something you don't like, you know, ignore it and go tell a trusted adult, which is a great strategy. Unfortunately, it doesn't always work. You know, it's hard to keep ignoring something. I'm being honest when that doesn't always work. It's a good strategy, but it doesn't always work. So what Connie Palmer's approach is that when somebody says something to you, you try and disarm them by bringing them to your level. So in other words, it's best if I just give you an example. If someone comes up to you and says, you've worn that shirt 3 times now, and you say, isn't it great? The green color, it like really brings out my eyes. And now you've taken, it's like you've taken the power away from that person who's trying to knock you down. You own it and you say, yeah, it's great, I love it, thanks. I'm glad you noticed. And so obviously the premise behind a bully is they're trying to get one up on you, and this completely takes the wind out of their sails and doesn't let them do that. And that's a lot easier said than done as an adult, or even as an adult, you know, how many times did you walk away from a situation and say, why, if I had just said this? And I understand with little kids, it's hard to have that repertoire of having something ready to go, ready to say, but it starts the conversation with them that it's another coping skill. It's another way to approach someone who does something unfair to you. And so she is gonna come into all of our fourth grade classes and teach the kids. She's great at role-playing with them, and she like invites them to insult her and be mean to her, and they think it's hysterical. But she gives a lot of good, like I said, good responses that hopefully some of them will take away from that. And then the goal is, and I love this, that this is her goal, is that she's not coming in, the JCs are financially supporting this initiative this year, but her goal is that our counselors will then be able to do this with the fourth graders next year. So she wants us to, you know, self-sustaining this type of curriculum. So that's coming up in the next month or so, and there'll also be a parent presentation to explain it to the parents as well. So that's Bullies to Buddies. I'll talk less about it for the next report period.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Lisa, I just want to thank you and your team and everyone that works together to create a warm, welcoming, and kind environment, because that's what it's all about. I appreciate the proactivity to make sure that kids are feeling comfortable. I know sometimes when people, parents especially, guardians especially, you know, start to hear about HIB, like immediately, right? It's a very, thorough process with words like investigation and determination, and it gets reported. And so I understand why through that legislation, you know, it gets people a little bit more anxious when they start hearing that. For our purposes, we're required, mandated to implement the law, but we do it in a way that is respectful of all. And to be honest with you, regardless of that determination, whether it turns out that it fits the legislative definition or not, whether it went through pre-screening and is a full, thorough investigation in that pathway or not, the outcome is still the same. We want to figure out what's going on here. We want to make sure that whoever is the recipient of unwanted behaviors is being supported and assisted, and those folks that might be, being the aggressor or the one that is, exhibiting these kinds of behaviors is we're pausing, giving them a chance to understand what these actions are doing, both from a therapeutic standpoint and a consequence standpoint, and make sure that those behaviors are extinguished and that we are learning something so that we can interact with folks in a much safer way in the future. So I really appreciate the fact that you and your team always focus on doing that in the most positive and respectful way, positive, to have the best outcome. So thank you, really, truly. All right, thank you, Lisa.
Sorry, Dr. Rubin. I know.
Yes.
As part of the code, we have to present this information, or Lisa presents the information, every 6 months for the previous 6 months of the school year regarding HIB and the anti-bullying law and all the things that were discussed earlier. Part of the code requires that we open up the meeting for any public comment on this report. There will be other audience participations in the agenda that you could speak freely on other topics, but would anyone from the public like to come up and speak on any of the information that was just presented regarding HIB? Okay, seeing none, that is now closed. Thank you.
Thank Great, you. Thank you, and thank you, Lisa. So to continue with my report, this one is hot off the presses here. We just got this on Friday. I think it was on Friday. We received a correspondence on behalf of Jordan Schiff, who's the Assistant Commissioner of Education in the state of New Jersey, and inviting Cranford to take part in the Promising Practices Project. The New Jersey Department of Education, in consultation with the New Jersey State Policy Lab and the Joseph C. Cornwall Center for Metropolitan Studies at Rutgers, their research team, is eager to learn from local education agencies, such as Cranford, who have been identified as providing exemplary work around the state to impact student academic performance. Specifically, the department would like to learn about innovative educational practices that are driving learning acceleration that emerged in response to the challenges that were posed by the pandemic. So the study is going to identify promising practices that may be emulated throughout New Jersey and the nation. The study will analyze the practices and activities that schools such as Cranford have implemented for learning acceleration and COVID-19 recovery, and the positive effect on student performance in the areas of English and mathematics. They found us through a quantitative analysis when Rutgers was doing research and identified us as having positive student learning outcomes when comparing pre to post pandemic performances, again, in both ELA and math, and concluded that Orange Avenue School was identified as a positive outlier. So they're going to be reaching out to us to take a look at the practices. And really, everyone shares in that pride. Certainly, Orange Avenue was identified based on the particular analysis that they did, but it's the same things and approach that we've done in Orange Avenue district-wide with similar results on the whole district-wide in terms of how we did pre- and post-pandemic. And I will tell you, that is certainly a point of pride in Bloomingdale and Orange Avenue School. It's really a credit to our staff, to our students, parents, guardians, our administrators, the board, and also community members, because it really was a huge team team effort during that pandemic. We were very quick to get in the room with everyone to try to talk about how we're going to approach this. We're very quick to say, hey, this isn't working, let's go around and come up with something new. Or no, this is working, let's press the pedal to the metal on this piece there. And it was really a tribute to everyone sort of just trying to figure out what is best for our community and working together. So really a tribute to everyone and especially our staff throughout that time. So kudos to everyone as we go forward. I'll share more information as we get more information on that exciting initiative. Also, in the same vein, Cranford's High School's Prologue Literary and Art Magazine was just recognized as excellent by the National Council of Teachers of English. The 2023 contest featured 375 student magazines from schools in 46 states and 5 countries. So, again, an amazing honor to our students and faculty. Absolutely fabulous. Very exciting to share that information. We also, the board, and also available on the back table, has the a draft of the 24-25 school calendar. This we had to wrestle with for a while here. This did not lay out as nicely as calendars in years past. I've talked with some of my colleagues. They also had some wrestling to do with this calendar. I think you know in Cranford, we do a really nice job of working with all of our partners, again, to come up with what is the best result for our community as a whole. This one, it won't surprise you. I vetted through the administrators, the teachers union, the PTAs, the PTCs, religious leaders. I really make sure that we're going through everyone and making sure that we're identifying what is the best for our community as a whole. What we finally decided to do here, a couple of changes that people will see. One is school will start. Actually, staff will come back on September 3rd and 4th. The first day of school for students will actually be a single session on that 5th. I got a lot of positive feedback. As you know, we did do a single session this year because of the heat and the weather warranted that. What I got feedback was that was actually a much better way to start the school year. So whether it's a heat day or not, we will have a single session there, all except for our freshman students that will have orientation that day as they typically do on that first day of school. So that is one change to look for. And then the other one is around the winter recess. It was very challenging. The way the calendar laid out, there's not a lot of wiggle room with some of these things. So it laid out that the 23rd, which is a Monday, would have been a single session, a half day going into the winter break. So people would have had the Saturday and Sunday, come in for a half day on Monday, and then had a lot of days off. Did not seem like that was going to be well received for anyone, or that really made a lot of sense. So after a lot of wrestling, what we did was include that in our days off and did that half day on the 20th, that Friday. But what that wound up doing was it's two emergency days going into the next year. We have not, I won't say that out loud, but it seems like data in the past has indicated that might work out well with only the 2 days. Obviously, if it turns out that something else happens, we'll have to take a look at that. But for now, we'll go into the next year with two emergency days and the rest of the calendar laid out pretty well. So any questions on the calendar? Okay, and we did go back and forth with all of those groups. We finally settled on this one. So look forward to that calendar to be on the next board agenda officially to be approved for next year. And we were just talking right before the meeting started, Rachel. We're like incredible that we're already knocking on February and thinking about the next school year. It's amazing how time flies and that happens. So that is the calendar. The last piece that I'll talk about is tomorrow is the day. January 23rd is tomorrow. That is the vote date. We will have a single session day. The vote will be from 2:00 to 8:00. So please make sure you are having your voice heard. We routinely get some questions about what have we done to make sure that all community members are aware of that vote. So I'm just going to take a couple moments just to share some of the things that we have done here to make sure that everyone's aware and then can make an informed decision. decision of what's best for themselves, for their family, and our community. We've held two information sessions, one virtual and one in person, to connect the community with the district leaders, teachers, and professional advisors. We met regularly with a bond referendum communications committee made up of citizens all across our community, representative who could help spread the word to others. We've distributed flyers at townwide events like the recent superhero stroll. We've mailed a postcard and sample ballot to all Cranford households. We've created and distributed a dedicated website and also a 5-minute informational video. We've placed an ad in Cranford Monthly and information in the town's newsletters, communicated updates to staff, parents from both the principals and myself. We've shared information regularly via social media and traditional news media. We've placed yard signs and banners around town. We've recorded segments on Cranford Radio and Cranford TV 35. We presented to multiple community groups that included the seniors, preschool parents, parents of school-age children, the township committee. Again, all of these efforts aimed at ensuring that all Cranford residents are aware of the vote. Obviously, this impacts every Cranford resident. So please check the website, view a recorded event. There were lots of questions that we fielded through the website. Any questions that we've received, we responded directly to those individuals that asked for that information. And we also updated our FAQs on the website to make sure that other people could potentially benefit from those other questions. We also had Q&As at these in-person events and also the virtual events. So people had, plenty of time to get answers to their questions. So we will update the community on the results tomorrow. The polls close at 8 o'clock. I don't know, somewhere maybe, again, I'm just guessing here. It's probably around somewhere between 9 and 10. We may know something. And so as soon as we have that information, we will absolutely update the community. We will update our website. We will update the bond referendum website, which is linked to our website, so you can take a look at that too. We'll send out an email to all the addresses we have. We'll update social media. So we will put all that out. I'm sure the clerk's office also has to update, various sources as well. But we will share that. Please make sure you're going out to vote and making your voice heard. And that is my report.
Thank you, Dr. Rubin. Does anybody have any questions for Dr. Rubin or any comments? All right. All yours.
Thank you. As part of my report tonight, the school district and all school districts in New Jersey have to go through what's called an annual audit. Auditors come out and they go through your financial information, they go through your internal controls and various other items that are the operations of the school district. In your packets, you receive two reports, one larger report, which is basically the financial statements, and a smaller report, which is actually the report on, it's a management report on any findings or anything that they have gone through when they reviewed the audit when they came out. So other than me going through it, which really I shouldn't be doing anyway, I'm going to turn the meeting over. We have two people from PKF O'Connor Davies, the auditing firm who performed the audit. And I'm going to call up Anthony Bronco, who's a partner with the firm, and Nicholas Costello, who's a supervisor with the firm, and they were on the job this year. So I'll turn it over to you, Anthony.
Thank you, Bob. As Bob mentioned, we issued two reports, one being an ACFR, one being an AMR. Right, so you have your annual comprehensive financial report, which is the larger report, and then you have an auditor's manager management report, which is the smaller report.
Could you just speak into the microphone?
Sure.
Sorry.
So as Bob mentioned, does that work? Okay, thank you. As Bob mentioned, so in summary, in the large report in the ACFR, we issue an independent auditor's report. We issue a single audit report, and we also issue what's called a GAS report. Basically, they each kind of go into different things, right? The independent auditor's report, we issue an opinion on the material accuracy of the financial statements. We also go into supplementary information and the like. From a single audit perspective this year, we had to perform a federal and a state single audit. On the state side, we tested the extraordinary aid program as well as the reimbursed TPAF contributions. And on the federal side, we tested the IDEA cluster. So with that, all three of the reports did not have any findings during the year. The financial statements were found to be materially accurate. We didn't have any issues with compliance over any of the major programs, as well over things such as the local public contracts law, et cetera. And with that, I also wanted to point out that the Cranford Public School District was one of 27% of school districts in the state of New Jersey that actually filed on December 5th. So congratulations to that. And that said, I'll open it up to any questions, if anybody has any questions for us.
No question, just a couple comments. So, you know, whether it's the right thing to do or not, I see this audit as like the final step when you look at the full year budget. You know, when you think about when it starts, where the building administrators provide their input and their requests, the administration sits down and tries to prioritize things. Bob, Scott meet with the finance committee. Finance committee reviews everything, gets passed on to the full board. It then gets voted on, and then gets sent to the county superintendent, then gets presented to the public, then gets approved, and then it's put into operation. To me, the fact that once it's put into operation, to read that there's no deficiencies in internal controls, it's a compliant budget, and there's no findings or recommendation, just underscores the great job that, you know, Bob, that you particularly do in making sure that we have a sound budget that not only meets the needs of the taxpayers, but does what's best what's in the best interest of the students in this school. And I know that there's a ton of competing priorities. When you look at the budget every year, everything from building maintenance to the social emotional well-being of the children to everything else in between. And we do a heck of a job as a board, but particularly Bob, kudos to you. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Patrick. And thanks to you and the Finance Committee and the full board and Dr. Rubin. It's a group effort, so we really appreciate that. And I'd like to thank Anthony and Nick and the team. I'd like to say it's always a pleasure, but having auditors out for a while, I'm looking at some. And as an ex-auditor, I could say that, but really they are very professional, and it's a pleasure to work with them, too. Thanks. So I do appreciate that. And any other questions? I didn't mean to cut in on the board's time for Anthony or myself or anything on the audit or the management report or anything. Yeah.
I just have one comment to back up what Mr. Lynch said. This is an audit that's had not any, it's matched the controls, it's matched up with the auditor for the past, I don't know how many years. This isn't something that doesn't, you know, this isn't just the first time. This is year after year after year that this has happened. I think there was one recommendation a while back that had to do with, you know, some surplus, things like that. So this is something that has gone on for years. So again, this is your team. You do a phenomenal job. So thank you. That's all.
Thanks. And I just, you know, thank you for, you know, coming to present tonight, answering any questions we have. Thank you for working with, you know, our employees too. We appreciate that as well. And as a board member, I just want to say that it's there's a lot of negativity sometimes, you know, that corresponds with the roles of sitting in this room. And I will say that one of the great functions of being and feeling safe in this room is the job that you do, because we always know that what we're signing off on, what we approve in any given agenda, we know that you're taking care of it well and your team is taking care of it well. So thank you for that, because that's one of the reasons I feel very comfortable sitting in this seat. So thank you.
I appreciate that, Kurt. And it's the support we also get from everybody here. So it works both ways, but thank you. So thank you. Thanks,
thank
Anthony.
You.
Thanks, Nick.
Thank you.
And the only thing, there's a resolution to accept the audit because it has to be presented at a public meeting, and that's part of the regular agenda. So that concludes my report.
Okay. We kind of went through it already, but before I move on, does anybody have any questions or any more comments for Bob? Okay, we will move on. Thank you, Bob. Okay, we are going to move on to communications. William, did you say you had a communication you wanted to share?
So under communications, the Union County School Board's Association will meet Wednesday, February 7th at 7 p.m. The topic of discussion will be budget development. And we are so fortunate, this is hot off the press, like Dr. Rubin says, we are so fortunate to have our own Bob Carfagno on a panel that night. So I encourage everyone to, it's virtual, so everybody can get on and attend. And Bob will be one of several borough administrators or administrators, a topic of discussion that night. So, yep, I hope everyone is able to attend.
I probably responded too fast. That's what happened.
Do you know that?
That's what it
was, Bob?
Yeah.
Anybody have any questions for William? Okay. Does anybody else have any communications they would like to share? Please, Terry.
Thanks, Mr. Petchow. I just want to take a minute as chair of the Communications Committee to thank the Community Communications Committee who participated in the bond referendum planning stage with us. You know, Dr. Rubin joined the district in 2017. He began a look, listen, and learn tour and really engaged with the community and the staff to learn what we needed as a district and sort of set a standard that the board has continued to invest in. And that is to follow what the community's wishes are. The people that served on the Community Communications Committee dedicated their time, their energy, their efforts. They represented our community really in all facets, and that was something that was very important to the board committee, that we did have representation throughout the committee, or throughout the community, rather. And these people took time at night away from their families to meet with us and the public relations firm that we employed to help with this process. And if I could take all of you into that room, you would have really seen how much value that those people brought to this process. So, you know, I wish I could name you all now, but the list is too vast. But you certainly know who you are, and we, as a committee and as a board, are very grateful for the time, the input, and the energy you gave to this. And you know, thank you. As we get ready to vote tomorrow, you know, it's an exciting day, and you get to see, you know, your input in this referendum plan. And we couldn't have done it without that committee. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Terry. Anybody have any questions for Terry? All right. Does anybody else have any communications they would like to share? All good. All right. We are going to move on. We are up to our first audience participation. So if anybody would like to come up and speak, just come up and give us your name and your municipality of residence, please. Maybe. Okay. All right, seeing nobody, we are going to move on. Does any board member have any committee reports or old or new business they would like to share? All good? Okay. Patrick, I'm going to throw it over to you. Can you please move the minutes of previous meetings?
Sure. I'd like to make a motion. Consideration of the minutes of previous meetings. December 11, 2023, regular monthly meeting, 7:15 p.m. December 11, 2023, executive session, 7:17 p.m.
Does anybody have any questions or comments on the minutes before we move them? Okay.
Mrs. Cohen.
I abstain.
Mr. Darling.
Yes.
Mr. Dreyer.
Yes.
Mr. Hulse.
Yes.
Mr. Colobus.
Abstain.
Mr. Lynch.
Yes.
Mrs. Shaw.
Yes.
Mrs. Soltis.
Yes.
Mr. Petchow.
Yes.
Motion carried.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to move to formal resolutions. Sue, will you please move resolutions 1 through 12?
I would like to make a motion to move resolution 1, business items. Resolution 2, approved revised budget statement 2023-2024. Resolution 3, Board Secretary's Monthly Certification Budgetary Line Item Status. Resolution 4, Acceptance of Donation. Resolution 5, Comprehensive Annual Financial Report. Resolution 6, Authorizing Participation in the Bi-Board National Purchasing Cooperative Agreement. Resolution 7, Authorizing Contracts with Certain Approved State Contract Vendors Pursuant to NJSA 18A : 18A -10A. Resolution 8, Approval of Travel Expenditures. Resolution 9, Field Trip Destination Approval. Resolution 10, HIB Decisions. Resolution 11, Workshop Presentation. And Resolution 12, Curriculum Resource and Lesson Planning.
Second.
Anybody have any comments, questions on 1 through 12? Dr. Rubin, you first.
Yeah, just one comment. So I always say this, I can't recall a board meeting where we were not accepting a donation and very appreciative. Usually, typically, it's a Cranford organization that's supporting the schools and assisting us. This one's different. This one is not, I don't believe this is a Cranford business. I think this is out of state. But still, I want to thank Josh's Benches for the donation of this bench to help promote awareness of mental health, depression, and suicide prevention. And that will reside in the courtyard over the high school. So we appreciate them. Even if they're not here in Cranford, we still certainly still appreciate the support that we get. So maybe it's catching on. That's great. Thank you.
Thank you. And I also wanted to draw attention to number 4, just because I wanted to thank Principal Cantagallo and everybody at the high school, including Lisa Burfeit, who was here earlier, for bringing this to our attention to allow us to accept this too. And, things of mental health, depression, and suicide is stuff that, in years past, and not even that long ago, was stuff that wasn't talked about all that often. Almost had a scarlet letter type attitude towards it. And I'm just very happy that we do what we can when we can to receive these kind of donations and just, draw attention to it and shine a light on it when it's needed. So I just wanted to draw attention to that as well. So thank you.
Okay. Sure. Okay. Mrs. Cohen.
Yes.
Mr. Darling.
Yes.
Mr. Dreyer.
Abstain 10. Yes, the rest.
Mr. Hulse.
Yes.
Mr. Colavis.
Yes.
Mr. Lynch.
Yes.
Mrs. Shaw.
Yes.
Mrs. Soltis.
Yes.
Mr. Petcha.
Yes.
Motion carried.
Thank you. Jess, will you please move resolutions 13 through 25 and 21 and 22 are revised.
Sure. I'd like to make a motion to move Resolution 13, Approval of Substitutes and Home Instructors. Resolution 14, Revised Substitute Rates. Resolution 15, Leave of Absence. Resolution 16, Contract Revisions. Resolution 17, Spring Volunteer Coaching Appointment. Resolution 18, Sixth Period Salary Adjustments. Resolution 19, Revised Additional Assignment Club. Resolution 20, Miscellaneous Additional Assignment Nursing. Revised Resolution 21, Miscellaneous Additional Assignment One-to-One Student Assistance Play. Revised Resolution 22, Miscellaneous Additional Assignment One-to-One Student Assistance Play. Resolution 23, Miscellaneous Additional Assignment CPR Training. Resolution 24, Administrator Mentor. And Resolution 25, Mentor Teacher.
Callahan, will you go over 21 and 22, please?
Of course. For resolutions 21 and 22, you'll note that a revision was made. It was necessary to update a pay rate on both of those resolutions.
Thank you. Does anybody have any questions on that or 13 through 25?
Just a comment on 23.
Please.
CPR training is so important. I know it's something that we have to do, but just in general, take a minute to get trained. You never know when you're going to need something to use that. So thank you.
Thank you, William. Anybody else? Okay.
Mrs. Cohen.
Yes.
Mr. Darling.
Yes.
Mr. Dreyer.
Yes.
Mr. Hulse.
Yes.
Mr. Colavis.
Yes.
Mr. Lynch.
Yes.
Mrs. Shaw.
Yes.
Mrs. Solkin.
Yes.
Mr. Petcha.
Yes.
Motion carried.
Thank you. We have a hand carried number 26. Terry, will you please move that?
I'd like to move hand carried resolution 26, appointments.
Second.
Take your pick. Mr. Callahan, would you please talk about number 26 also?
Of course. For the board's consideration, we've added resolution for two appointments. Given the timing of which these packets were received, this was necessary. On a side note on this resolution, both of these individuals being appointed are current substitutes aspiring to provide more regular service to our schools, and it really is always a pleasure to see the individuals subbing in our schools are finding it to be a desirable setting. With that, I would just stress to the community and the greater community, we are always accepting applications for substitutes in various capacities.
Thank you. Any questions or comments on that? It was well said. Okay.
Okay. Mrs. Cohen.
Yes.
Mr. Darling.
Yes.
Mr. Dreyer.
Yes.
Mr. Hulse.
Yes.
Mr. Colavis.
Yes.
Mr. Lynch.
Yes.
Mrs. Shaw.
Yes.
Mrs. Soltis.
Yes.
Mr. Petcha.
Yes.
Motion carried.
Great. Thank you. All right. That is it for our formal resolutions. We are up to our second audience participation. If anybody would like to come up and ask any questions or make any comments, just please give us your name and your municipality of residence, please. Okay, seeing nobody, we do not need executive session. We do not need an executive session. So I need a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you, everyone, and be safe, and don't forget to vote tomorrow.
That's it. Be safe. Don't forget to vote. Thank you.